So apparently Jack Dorsey and Twitter think that predictions are susceptible of being fact-checked.
Okay.
Viva Frei, Montreal litigator turned YouTuber, vlogging at you yet again from my car. There's a little bit of an overcast today, which makes for the perfect lighting, actually. It's quite beautiful. So Donald Trump is yet again in the news, and it is yet again because of one of his tweets. As most of you are undoubtedly aware, it is 2020 and it is an election year in the United States of America. As most of you are also probably aware, most of the world has been on lockdown as a result of the My Sharona Cyrus, as we call it on this channel. As a result of America being on lockdown and this being an election year, there has been some discussion as to how people are going to vote safely come November 2020. And some states are floating the idea of mail-in ballots, which some people are taking issue with, including the President of the United States of America. And on May 26th, Donald Trump, who I'm sure is going to go down in the annals of history as being the Twitter president, tweeted as follows. There is no way, zero, that mail-in ballots will be anything less than substantially fraudulent. Mailboxes will be robbed, ballots will be forged, and even illegally printed out and fraudulently signed. The governor of California is sending ballots to millions of people. Anyone living in the state, no matter who they are or how they got there, will get one. That will be followed up with professionals telling all these people, many of whom have never even thought of voting before, how and for whom to vote. This will be a rigged election, no way. And sorry for raising my voice there, it's just whatever I see on Twitter.
I feel like someone is yelling at me.
So Trump posted those tweets on Twitter, and right below those tweets, you'll notice a little blue icon of an exclamation point in a circle followed by "Get the facts about mail-in ballots." Twitter added a tab, a hyperlink, to fact-check Donald Trump's tweets. And when you click on that blue icon, this is the first result that shows up. Trump makes unsubstantiated claim that mail-in ballots will lead to voter fraud. On Tuesday, President Trump made a series of claims about potential voter fraud after California Governor Gavin Newsom announced an effort to expand mail-in voting in California during the My Sharona Cyrus Schmendrick. These claims are unsubstantiated, according to CNN, Washington Post, and others. Experts say mail-in ballots are very rarely linked to voter fraud. Photo via CNN Politics. So some people might have taken some issue with the fact that Twitter is using CNN and Washington Post to fact-check the president. I don't think a great many people need a reminder as to why CNN and WAPO are possibly not the most credible fact-checkers to be fact-checking anyone. That is one issue. Who exactly are these fact-checkers that are fact-checking anybody? When it's CNN and the Washington Post, people might get a little irked. I mean, if CNN and WAPO are the fact-checkers, who's gonna fact-check the fact-checkers?
If you're the police, who will police the police?
Oh, Coast Guard?
Setting aside the potential lack of credibility of the fact-checkers fact-checking the president, you have these fact-checkers fact-checking a prediction. One can disagree with a prediction and provide arguments for why they disagree with it, citing historical examples, but it is impossible, by definition, to fact-check a prediction. Setting aside who they used to fact-check the president, a lot of people took issue with Twitter unilaterally deciding to fact-check the president in the first place, and the president was one of those people. And true to form, living up to the moniker Twitter president, on May 27th, Donald Trump tweeted as follows. Republicans feel that social media platforms totally silence conservative voices. We will strongly regulate or close them down before we can ever allow this to happen. We saw what they attempted to do and failed in 2016. We can't let a more sophisticated version of that happen again. Just like we can't let large-scale mail-in ballots take root in our country. It would be a free-for-all on cheating, forgery, and the theft of ballots. Whoever cheated the most would win. Likewise, social media. Clean up your act now!
I'm having difficulty controlling the volume of my voice!
Just so we're clear, when I refer to Donald Trump as the Twitter president, I am saying it non-judgmentally. I think it's actually kind of interesting the way politicians have used Twitter to spread their messages. I don't have any fundamental problem with politicians using Twitter subject to the message they are conveying. That said, when it comes to the message Donald Trump is conveying in that particular tweet, I have something of an issue with it. In law, in life, and especially as a parent, I am in the habit of not making threats that I cannot follow through on. And so when Trump makes the threat to regulate or shut them down, it's an empty threat because everybody knows no one's going to shut them down. That, and for those of you who've been hanging on my channel for long enough, you will know that I've said in the past, as a lawyer, I never make threats failing which I will file ethical or statutory or criminal complaints. Making those type of threats to coerce some sort of a settlement can, in fact, be deemed to be extortion. So while I am not a fan of making empty threats that everybody knows you cannot and will not follow through on, I am also not a fan of making threats of some sort of regulatory sanction in the event of non-compliance. Do it or don't do it, but don't make a threat about doing it if you don't get what you want. And constitutional expert Jonathan Turley feels the same. For those of you who don't remember who Jonathan Turley is, he was one of the experts that testified during the impeachment hearings.
How does this trend comport with how the founders understood impeachment should operate?
Well, I believe that the founders certainly had aspirations that we would come together as a people, but they didn't have any delusions. It certainly was not something that they achieved in their own lifetime.
If you don't already follow Jonathan Turley on Twitter, go follow him. You will certainly learn something from following his feed. But when it comes to Donald Trump's tweet, Jonathan Turley on Twitter wrote as follows. The president's threat is chilling and wrong. It is a circular call for retaliatory regulation to deter the viewpoint bias. It is akin to denouncing those without fire detectors by threatening to burn their homes down. For those of you who have been hanging around the channel long enough, you will also know that I say it is useless arguing from imperfect analogies when you have perfect examples. Turley's analogy fails because I do think you would get people to get fire detectors by threatening to burn their houses down, but that doesn't make it right to do that. But on the substance, I tend to agree with Jonathan Turley in that it looks like retaliatory regulation as opposed to merely corrective regulation. And threatening to shut someone down, i.e. to censor someone because they censored you, well, that just doesn't make a lot of sense either. Forget the threats, forget the tweets, we know there's a problem, just fix the problem. Incidentally, I did a vlog on this about a year ago when Twitter initially announced that they were going to be potentially flagging tweets from politicians if they deemed those tweets to be containing inaccurate or false information. The substance of that vlog and the warnings I made in it have aged quite well. What hasn't aged quite as well is the production value of that vlog. It is about a 10 on 10 for cringe, but I'm going to show you the highlights right now.
Do you want to get your Section 230 immunity revoked? Because this is how you get your Section 230 immunity revoked.
All right, Twitter has announced that it is doing something that can only be described as either poking the bear or the boiling frog. Twitter has announced that it is going to start censoring or flagging or giving warnings to tweets coming from official public officials, like members of government, if those tweets are deemed to be violating the terms of service of Twitter, whatever those terms of service are. Thursday, 27 June 2019. Our highest priority is to protect the health of the public conversation on Twitter, and an important part of this is ensuring our rules and how we enforce them are easy to understand.
No comment.
To fix that, we're introducing a new notice that will provide additional clarity in these situations and sharing more on when and why we'll use it. Section 230 of the Communications and Decency Act reads as follows. No provider or user of an interactive computer service shall be treated as the publisher or speaker of any information provided by another information content provider. They're going to make the argument that they can't be held liable because of the immunity provided for under Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act? Dude, if you want to play that game, you are playing with fire, you are poking a bear, and that bear is the government. And I don't even know what I'm more scared of. Free reign of the tech giant or government intervention. But one thing is clear, Twitter is poking a bear with this move. Twitter is a company that is effectively now saying it gets to decide when it censors the government. That is basically big tech thumbing its nose at the government, who has the power to regulate it if they see abuse. Definitely to be followed, because there will be fallout from this, either legal or legislative.
It didn't take a tremendous amount of foresight, but I did forewarn that that notice that Twitter was talking about implementing would lead to this very issue. Poking the government bear who has the power to regulate you overnight to the point where they come in and regulate you overnight. In that vlog, I also discussed the history and context of Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, and I briefly went over the two key decisions to explain the raison d'etre of Section 230 CDA. I'll show you that highlight now. If you want to watch the entire vlog, I'm going to link that vlog right here. Give it a watch if you have some time, and if you don't want to watch any of it, just skip right past this point. I'm going to put a time marker as to where you can skip to in this video.
This provision of the CDA was specifically added in 1996 to respond to certain concerns that platforms on the newly developed and ever-expanding internet would be held liable for the content uploaded by their users, and as such, it would kill the growth of the internet. It would kill the entire industry if platforms and service providers were held liable for all of the illegal and wrongful acts of their users. And to understand the context of Section 230, we have to go back to 1991 to a CompuServe decision. CompuServe was the first major online service provider in the United States. In 1991, CompuServe was sued for defamation by Cubby because apparently some defamatory content was posted online on CompuServe's platform. CompuServe's defense was that they did not and could not know that that defamatory content was on their platform because they didn't do any moderating or verification of the user-generated content that was uploaded to their platform. And they were subsequently not held liable for the defamatory content because they were deemed to have not known or could not have known that that defamatory content was on their platform. Fast forward to 1995 and you have the Stratton versus Prodigy lawsuit, and that's virtually the same as CompuServe with one major difference. In the Prodigy lawsuit, you had the plaintiff Stratton Oakmont suing Prodigy and a user on Prodigy's platform who uploaded defamatory content to the platform. The details don't really matter. The bottom line is that the lawsuit was virtually identical to the CompuServe lawsuit with one major difference. Prodigy moderated the content that was uploaded onto its platform, and in so doing, the court came to the conclusion that they exercised editorial control over the content that was on their platform, and as such were held liable for the defamatory nature of the content uploaded to that platform. And it was in this context that Section 230 of the CDA was implemented, so that internet service providers
providers who did attempt to ensure that there was no illegal or defamatory content uploaded to their platforms would not be held liable as a result of actually engaging in moderation. And you could sort of see the concern that Section 230 was responding to. In Prodigy, you had the platform being held liable because it did in fact make an attempt to moderate, whereas in CompuServe, the company was not held liable because it didn't attempt to moderate. And so we were sort of faced with a paradoxical situation where a company that was in fact moderating the content that was uploaded to its platform was held to a higher standard than a company that did no moderation whatsoever. And Section 230 was implemented so that internet service providers and platforms could attempt to moderate illegal and defamatory content without running the risk of themselves being held liable for that defamatory content.
It didn't require much intelligence or foresight, but I predicted it. There was going to be fallout, either legal or legislative, and Donald Trump has announced that he is issuing an executive order to deal with this problem. If it's not going to be issued today, it's going to be issued in the imminent future. As of now, all we have are reports on apparent drafts that people have seen, but before I even get into that, I want to get into a solution proposed by one Robert Barnes. No doubt, simpler solution is a one-sentence amendment to existing law. Any publicly traded social media company keeps Section 230 immunity as long as they comply with First Amendment standards as if they were a governmental entity when acting in the capacity of a publisher. Robert Barnes is a smart man, and if you don't follow him on Twitter, he is yet another person you should follow on Twitter. That is Robert Barnes' proposal, and although the executive order has not yet been issued, let's just see how the media is reporting on what is going to be in that executive order based on the drafts that people have seen. The draft of the executive order also calls for the Federal Communications Commission, FCC, to spell out what type of content blocking will be considered deceptive, pretextual, or inconsistent with the service provider's terms and conditions. A review of government advertising on social media sites and whether those platforms impose viewpoint-based restrictions. The re-establishment of the White House tech bias reporting tool that lets citizens report unfair treatment by social networks. So that is a summary of the current situation. When the executive orders come out, I'm going to do a Vlawg on those executive orders, and with any luck, a live stream with Robert Barnes on that issue. Just to finish this Vlawg on Twitter's justification for why they flagged Donald Trump's initial tweets and got into this mess in the first place. Twitter safety. We added a label to two real Donald Trump tweets about California's vote-by-mail plans as part of our efforts to enforce our civic integrity policy. We believe those tweets could confuse voters about what they need to do to receive a ballot and participate in the election process. We also wanted to provide additional context and conversation with regard to voter fraud and mail-in ballots. We have a range of remediations, and in some cases we add labels that link to more context. At the end of the day, Twitter alone brought this problem on themselves. There was absolutely no reason to add a label to Donald Trump's tweets, and there was even less of a reason to fact-check a tweet that was ultimately nothing more than a prediction. If Twitter wanted to clarify or add context, they could have just retweeted. They added a label to make a point. And as they say, for every action is an equal opposite reaction, and right now we are seeing that opposite reaction, and it is coming by way of executive order in the near future. So stay tuned, I'm going to be doing a follow-up Vlawg on that, and by the way, if you like my videos and you like my content, please be sure to like, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell, drop a comment in the comment section below because it feeds the algorithm. If you want to support the channel, all of the support links are in the pinned comment. We've got merch, PayPal, Subscribestar, Patreon, you know, all the ways of supporting a channel. But above all else, take care of yourselves, stay safe, stay healthy, check in on your friends, family, neighbors, make sure everyone around you is doing fine, and now you know your Vlawg. Peace out. Booyah.